So school is back for some. It's starting soon for others. And my question is, has bullying gotten worse, or are we just reporting it more? And that's not a problem if we are reporting it more, and not it's I don't think that's actually the issue, but I read a report. So the Boys and Girls Club of America did an annual survey, and they found that bullying in schools has shot up over the past 5 years. And I'm curious because I do not have a child of school age yet. Greg Bach on the board also does not have school age children.
Nope.
And I, but I also, like, Greg, were you bullied? Oh,
Yes.
yes.
From
Were
a
you
very, very
physically,
young age.
both physically and mentally, like, and emotionally
No.
bullied? Because
No, very.
I feel like you, for people who do not know what Greg looks like, I feel like you'd be a hard person to physically bully if you were
Well,
similar
I wasn't.
stature as a kid.
Wasn't this size when I was eight?
No, but you know what I mean? Like, I was always tall, right? Like, I've
Yeah.
always been I was always like the at least the tallest girl, if not the tallest kid.
Yeah, I was bullied mostly. It was mostly verbal and mental. Very few times was I tried would they try to beat me up. I was always like a pudgy kid, or then I was a tall kid, then I was a big tall kid, and very few times do people try to come at me physically. They just knew, let's go after his mental status. He like, you know how like, you know, the Death Star has that like that drainage hole in it that just like just happens to be the thing that will destroy it every time. Shot it every single time in there and just
Nailed it.
like
Target, the bullseye
from
every time.
every single time. Just
God.
the rebel wins every single time. Yeah, from a very from first grade until probably about like it's hard to say like early high school.
Early high school.
Yeah.
And so that's why I asked. Like, I don't know if I was ever bullied. I got kicked out of my group of girlfriends in like sixth grade, right? So it's like I had a group of girlfriends. All of a sudden, one day I showed up at school. They didn't want to be my friends anymore. And then they kind of bullied me. And there was the random, you know how you had to share textbooks? Like in like middle school, at least for us, like we had the morning class was, you know, English and social studies, and then we swapped with the other class to have our science and math teacher
Oh,
in the afternoon.
we didn't do that.
So we did that. So we shared books. So instead of all having our own books. And so I remember opening one of the books one day and someone had written something about me that it was, you know, Kristen Bry's a slut or something like, you know, something middle school it
Jesus.
like. And
I give you credit. At least in sixth grade, you had friends.
but and that's the thing. And I had left my parochial school because I had felt like I didn't fit in there either. And I wasn't necessarily bullied there. I didn't feel like I had any friends. And so I don't remember necessarily being bullied, but certainly I was not scot-free as not having kids be mean to me at one point during childhood. And I'm not going to say it's a rite of passage, but I also feel like, especially physical bullying, I
Yeah.
feel like there's such a lower threshold for that in schools now that
Oh, now especially.
to see the rates and this survey from Boys and Girls Club say that it's only going up. Is it that it's actually going up, or it's just that kids are reporting it more?
I have to think that it might. So here's my thoughts on this, because I even though I hated my grade school and middle school time, is very painful. I'm thankful I had it then, because now, like, I don't know as far as reporting going up, I think they're reporting it more, but there are also new avenues of bullying. I mean, when I was young, kid, like the most that it could do to quote unquote cyberbully you is call you on the phone. Now, like, kids are making up whole new Facebook accounts to go after kids, and that is terrifying. That is terrifying to me.
If you have thoughts on this, 844-967-2789. That's 844-96 party. Especially if you have grandkids or kids this age or have more recent proximity to the issue, if you're a teacher, do you feel like bullying has changed since you were in school? Whether it's gotten worse, it's different. But I just think as the school year starts, this is interesting data, but it's also trying to put it in context because, you know, it's like the classic, like when it finally became okay to be left-handed.
Yeah.
Because for a really long time, the nuns would slap you with a ruler if you tried to use your left hand. And so like the rates of reporting of being left-handed were very low until it became okay. And then it's like, oh, look at all these left-handed people. And so, you know, like has bullying rates always been bad? It just has not been reported. And so I think that's kind of what I'm interested in hearing from people who either have kids right now or still just have thoughts on like what the atmosphere looks like. 844-967-2789. And so, because I do think in general, I think Vox had an article recently that was like, people don't know how to act in public anymore. And so when we think about what adults have been doing in at concerts, like throwing things at artists or acting out on airplanes or, you know, all of this antisocial behavior, like, are we really, is that also feeding into this of like years of pandemic disruption and causing kids to like not know how to handle stress, like be worse at problem solving, be worse at peer relationships. And like, is this also another part, like, is the bullying emotional, like antisocial behavior also part of this out of the pandemic in the same way that we've seen it with adults?
I mean, I just have this feeling that if people are like post-pandemic acting out, it was always in them. I don't think that they were. I think we see more people being jackwads in public, and so somehow we think it's accepted. You know, it's like, I can throw this, I can do this, I can speak to this human being like they are nothing because I saw some lady on TikTok or Instagram do it, and that's how I feel. No, that's just, it's not, it's, and to me, and what's weird is that, like, and I don't like to use the word PTSD or traumatic or anything like that. That's for, you know, other discussions, but there is an inner thing inside me when I see people acting like that in public. Like, that's just another way of bullying, because you're just trying to get your way and do your thing without any sort of consequences whatsoever. And so when you act that way in public and we see it on the airwaves, it's like, you're just a low rent bully is what you are, because you just want to get away with it.
But that's my point. It's like, is there a connection there between stuff in schools and stuff with adults?
Are you mean like, were these people bullied in school as kids? Or?
No, I mean, in the same way that in the increase of the things that we're seeing of antisocial behavior in adults, is that also correlated to an increase in bullying in schools compared, like, according to this survey?
I mean, that could very well be. Yeah, I mean, not being around kids a whole lot, I can't really tell you that much. I'm around adults more than anything else, and I see their actions and their, you know, what they do in public. So I mean, my, like you were saying before about the whole left-handed thing, my father was left-handed, went to Catholic school and got beaten with a ruler. Because of that, traumatic effects for him. Traumatic.
Well, I'm pretty sure my dad, because my dad like does both. Like certain things he uses his left hand for, certain things he uses his right hand for. Like I think like even sports, it's different. Writing, it's different. How he eats, like eating, I think he eats with his left hand, but like, yeah, I think if I'm getting this story correct, it was also due to Catholic school. Thank you, Catholic school. But here are some more of the stats that came out of that article. So 40% of child and teen respondents, and I should say that this 130,000 students between 9 and 18 year olds were surveyed for this report. So 40% of child and teen respondents said they were bullied on school campuses in the past year. 18% said they experienced cyberbullying. And a quote from Dorothy Espledge, who is the professor of education at University of North Carolina, kids have regressed in their social skills, ability to work with other kids, conflict management. They're a little bit more unregulated. And so at least for them, like they've been doing this survey for years now, and by the numbers, so the numbers who said they were bullied on campus this year was 14 percentage points higher than 5 years ago before the COVID pandemic. So in 2019, it's 26%. This year, it's 40% with a steady increase year over year. So I don't know. I guess the question is, has bullying gotten worse, actually, or are we just reporting it more? 844-967-2789. We got Karina on the phone.
Yes, we do. Karina, go ahead.
Hi, guys. Good morning. Well, you know what? Bullying is a horrible thing. It's just like, what is really happening in somebody's head that allow themselves more, you know, any way to make somebody else feel bad. I mean, you have to enjoy that because it's not something what would be to me a normal, enjoyable thing that I'll hurt somebody.
Well,
one, and two, what I want to say, and maybe it sounds silly because, you know, we all people, we have our own mind. We were given so many freedoms, but at the same time, look what we have in the country right now. We have a bigger bully bullying everybody, government, law, the justice system, people are threatening, constantly threatening judges, senators. I mean, the government officials and the females. When this is happening on such a high level, then the simple people who live their own lives every day getting an idea that if everybody driving high speed, why wouldn't I?
Yeah.
So yeah. Most likely if there is a 10 cars driving high speed, I probably not going to get caught. Or how come everybody else can do it and I can't? This is the first mentality.
Yep.
And this is the worst of humanity. Worst of the humanity, because we're talking about, we hear that on the,
unfortunately,
on the
Karina, we are coming up against a break, so we got to let you go, but thank you as always for your call. If you have thoughts on this, has bullying gotten worse or are we just reporting it more? 844-967-2789. That's 844-96-PARTY. We'll be right back.
You can take me down with just one single blow.
Welcome back to As Goes Wisconsin. I am Kristen Bry. Greg Bach is on the board, and we are talking about bullying and whether or not it has gotten worse. Like it says it has, according to a new study from the Boys and Girls Club called the Youth Right Now Survey. And as we said right before the break, it's over the last 5 years. So since, God, is that 5 years now? It's wild to think that 2019 is... Like apparently, yeah, because 2019, 2020, 2021, 2022, 2023, that's 5 years of surveys for them. That does not feel like it was 5 years ago. That is terrifying.
Doesn't feel good. Doesn't feel good.
I think I was doing the math on that the other day of someone who graduated. I guess I saw someone who graduated from college in 2017, which is like, you know, that makes them like at least 10 years younger than me. And I still think of someone who graduated college in 2017 as like, young and like, yeah. Oh, like they haven't been in the workforce that long. And I was like, oh no, like that was like six, seven years ago. Like
they're almost like, 30.
They're like in their late like 20s. Like, never mind.
You know, something I want to go back to with Karina's discussion about bullying that I thought was very important to point out though is, you know, if we're talking about older people, yeah, I understand what she's saying as far as people like really like to see other people suffer, but I also don't think that's entirely true personally, because, you know, as someone who was very bullied a lot as a kid, you do a lot of thinking about those people and you think about where they come from and what they think and how they were raised, and you try to have empathy for them. It's hard to, but you try. And I don't know if they liked it because they may come from a home where that sort of behavior is the way you show love. Because a lot of times, especially with young kids, you tell them, the what you're doing to this kid is hurting them. They might not even know. They're like, I didn't know that because that's in my house. This is how you do things. And I don't truly believe it's some little kid saying, I like to hurt people. I think it's a hurting kid who's just trying to find love or express themselves. And the only way they know how to do it is through negative behavior. And what I'm hoping is as more bullying is being reported now, we can help those kids find out what's going on. Like, is there something going on at home? Is there something going on up in the mind that is making you act this way? And how do we address it? Because when I was younger, kids didn't go to therapy. If you went to therapy, like you were, like you were in trouble. So like the fact
or
that
your parents were getting divorced.
Yeah. I mean, like you were, there was, you were the talk of the cul-de-sac, but I mean, even though like bullying is terrible, I love the fact that it's being reported more. And I think we're hopefully like looking at children and saying, how do we help them? How do we help the parents too?
And I think that's my point. I'm not trying to sit here. Like, I think there's some people who make the art like kids are soft now. Like, oh, this is just like, kids can't take it. Like I got bullied. I'm fine. Look at me.
Yeah.
Like I'm not.
No, you're not, sir. No, you are not.
I'm not trying to make that argument at all. Yeah. As far as like, oh, we just need to toughen these kids up. And yeah. I think it's fine that if like, even if the reason is reporting is going up, I don't think that's a bad thing, but it's like, has it actually changed? Cause I do feel like there's always been bullying. I actually think physical bullying probably used to be worse. Because it used to, like, I think that there is a way more zero tolerance policies in schools now where things just like get nipped in the bud quickly than there used to be. And so it's more of, is it changing? Is it just getting reported more? And I would love to hear from you. Has bullying gotten worse or are we just reporting it more? 844-967-2789. That's 844-96-PARTY. And to go back, because were you ever on the other side, Greg?
You know, that was a question I was going to ask you too. Yeah, I definitely, but I never, it was never a like one-on-one thing that I can remember. I'm sure, you know, I'm sure there's probably some kid who was like, yeah, you were a total jerk to me in school, but I definitely would join the pack so that the bullying wasn't happening to me. It's like fight or flight or survival mode. You're like, oh, everyone's now making fun of him. Okay, let's do this together because I don't want to go home crying again. And that's no way to live. And that's not cool. But I was also 9 or 10. So yeah. I'm sure I engaged in the bullying.
I remember distinctly, I think in my sophomore year, I remember like, I think we were kind of mean to the girls younger, like the year younger than us.
Yeah.
And I don't remember. I have no idea why. Like, I can't remember of like, what any of them did or anything. Like, so it was like, there was a some mean, like there was some, I'm trying to like, I engaged probably in some like mean girl type behavior and like group think, but I certainly never was like, I have it out for this person.
Yeah.
And then
I'm going to destroy her. Their,
like every day, my goal is to make this person cry. Like I was never big shock. I was never that kid. Yeah. But I'm trying to think back to like motivation. Cause like especially with the cyberbullying stuff, because that stuff is so intentional and like you are now going out of your way to be sending DMs and sending like and starting rumors and I try to like is that now just the escalated equivalent to, you know, whatever girl wrote that about me in the textbook?
I mean, it's the evolution of the practice really when it comes down to it. That's, I mean, it sucks to say that and it's a horrible thing, but these practices evolve over time with technology, and where one kid would open up a directory in 1987 and call you and pretend to be somebody else. Now what they're going to do is they're going to get on Twitter or X or Facebook and DM Facebook. Like kids are on Facebook. You know, they're going to get a hold of you privately.
Snapchat, try to
ruin you and ruin your life. I mean, bullies are creative and bullies move with the times.
But also, like, and this is probably opening up another can of worms that we would have to talk to a child psychologist about, but like the differences between bullying and being mean.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, what is the distinction of where it crosses over of actual bullying versus a mean comment or an unregulated reaction to something that a kid said? And so I don't know. If you have thoughts on this, I'd love to still hear. I think this is a fascinating topic. I'm surprised we haven't had more people weigh in on this, because it's, I think we all got bullied to a certain extent. But so if you would like to text or call 844-967-2789, what was your experience with bullying? This is As Goes Wisconsin. And it would help if I unmuted my mic. welcome back.
Technology.
I am Kristen Bry, your host. Greg Bach is on the board. And we are talking about, we're wrapping up our conversation around bullying. And because I saw a headline this morning from Axios covering a survey from Boys and Girls Club, their annual Youth Right Now survey that showed the rates of bullying are going up. And would also be interesting because as the rates of kids and teens saying they are being bullied, I wonder how much if they ever talk to kids like, I am bullying more. Like, I wonder, like, do you think, like, there's ever any kids who are like, no, I know that I've gotten meaner, like, are that self-aware?
Well, no, I attended some workshops this summer, really, really sharpened my skills. I don't really do the violence, the physical stuff. I really just try to crack them. Do you ever see Star Wars? You know how the Death Star has that little hole in it? That's what I do. I get in
Target
there.
Target process.
It's about smart working practice. Smarter, not harder.
Exactly. Well, we got a comment on the YouTube live stream from Michael. The difference between being mean and bullying is interesting to me. I feel like that line moved in recent years. Being on the receiving end of either is not fun, though. So I looked that up during the break, and there's a, when you say, you just Google, you know, the difference between bullying and being mean. And there's a couple different things that pop up, and I just grabbed the first one. This is from don'tbeamonster.org. Which is a serious website. And so
it's a nonprofit.
It's a nonprofit that is about bullying. And so they say in the short terms, I'm not going to read everything, but being rude is inadvertently saying or doing something that hurts someone else. Being mean, purposefully saying or doing something to hurt someone, maybe once or twice. Bullying, intentionally aggressive behavior repeated over time that involves an imbalance of power. It is willful, repeated, and harmful. Often it is targeted on one person. So I think that's actually a really good definition as far as the intentionality of it, the repetitiveness of it, and the power part of it, I think is interesting as far as the whether it's physical power or social clout, so like the popular kids, or feeling like, because often I feel like there's been kids who say mean things in class, but like if they don't have this, for lack of, if they don't have like the social standing and like the respect of their peers, everyone can kind of just be like, whatever, they're just being mean, and it's mean, but you don't take it as like an imbalance of power. And I think those all like stand to be like being an adult too.
It's generational mean. You're new mean. You know, this is generational mean we're doing here. My father was mean. My grandfather was mean. My great-great-grandfather came on the Mayflower. He was mean.
It's like Billy Madison. O'Doyle rules. Like, O'Doyle, I think your whole family is going to get it down. Deep cut. And then we also had a text from the 608 West in Middleton. I think the social media culture we are in now is lowering everyone's self-esteem, especially children's. In my mind, when I think of a bully of any age, I think of someone with deep insecurities that feels the need to tear down others in order to feel more secure about themselves. I totally agree with that.
And I think that goes back to what I was saying in the last segment, which is we have to look at why kids and adults do this behavior, and can always be traced back to their parenting and the parenting they've received or did not receive and the situations they were raised in. Because it's just, I mean, unless you're like two loving, wonderful parents and you just birth a child and the child's like, nope, I'm just gonna be mean, that's a different thing. But most of the time you can really look back at these kids' lives and say, this is why you did it. And I mean, per example, and Karina brought it up herself. Karina brought up the bully in chief. Mm-hmm. When you think of Donald Trump, you can think a ton of things, but honestly, one of the first things I think of now, because it's just so easy to be mad at him and angry and do all the things, but I actually have a level of empathy for him because this was a young man raised in a family where he did not have a chance. He was born into
wealth. He didn't have a chance to be emotionally competent.
No, that's what I was trying to say is he was born into wealth, but he wasn't born into love. And he was shown quickly at a very young age that love is not something that comes easy or if ever from your parents. And when you have that sort of upbringing, it's not uncommon for it to be reflected out. And he amplifies it because he can, because we allow him as a society, whether you love him or hate him. We look at him and he just says, how far can I go to get this attention? I just want attention. Please look at me. It doesn't matter how I get it.
Yeah. And I think it's a good point as far as the what social media is doing to all ages as far as our insecurity versus security. But also, I mean, it also makes sense of why if insecurity and finding your place in the social hierarchy of, you know, your school, your community, your where you fit in the world, like all of that, especially in middle school, is like the worst, right? Like it's like your first awakening is around 11 or 12, where you start thinking, caring like deeply about what everyone else thinks of you.
Yeah.
And so just to have insecurity be so rampant at that age and how much that feeds into all of this. Got one more text from Judy in East Troy. Good morning. Going from public school in sixth grade to Catholic school for seventh and eighth was just being ignored, and that it is also hard for kids to not feel included. So that's also a thing, right? Like not being included is different than bullying. Still feels bad, but it's not necessarily like you're being targeted. And so I think that's why like definitions matter, because I think growing up is hard no matter what. And so that's why kind of what like that headline originally struck me, because I was like, is it all bullying, or are we letting kids define what bullying is? And that could be not being included. That could be someone who was mean to them, but it wasn't necessarily targeted, and you treat it all the same. I don't know. 844-967-2789. If you still have thoughts on this, we will certainly read your texts or take your calls, but we are going to move on to some headlines, the good, the bad, and the, that's wasteful. The good. So this is not a headline. This is a tweet that then got corroborated by looking at the set lists. But Waukesha's Rainbow Land saga continues in an unexpected way, with hundreds of thousands of people singing along with Rainbow Land because of Waukesha School's own Jin Siebert. The Chicks, formerly known as the Dixie Chicks, are covering Rainbow Land at each of their concerts right now. And so since May, they have done a cover of Rainbow Land in all of their sets.
I love it. I love it.
And so the Chicks do an incredible cover of Miley Cyrus and Dolly Parton's song of inclusion and acceptance. One must think Melissa Temple, who was the teacher who was fired from Waukesha, is smiling, knowing that standing up for what's right is having a notable impact around the country and the world. So again, this wasn't written up anywhere. I saw this as a tweet, and then our friend Dave Driggenberg did some follow-up and said, indeed, they have included that in all of their sets. And I don't know I haven't gone to a Chicks concert, but so I don't know if they are talking about it and talking about Waukesha in their concert, but very cool, nevertheless.
Yay. I have more reason to love the Chicks so much.
I do love the Chicks. I do.
Such a good combo.
All right. So the bad. If you have not heard yet, Jacksonville, Florida is in mourning, because on Saturday, a white gunman opened fire at a Dollar General store and killed three Black people, which included 52-year-old Angela Michelle Carr, 29-year-old AJ Laguerre, and 19-year-old Gerald Deshaun Gallion. And authorities said the gunman died after shooting himself. And the 21-year-old shooter was armed with an AR-15 and a Glock handgun that he bought legally, because, correct me if I'm wrong, but Florida has permitless concealed carry. And witnesses said one of the guns was painted with swastikas, and that the shooter made racist statements before opening fire. I guess he had tried to get onto the Edward Waters University campus, which is a small HBCU, but was asked to leave by on-campus security. And collectively, everyone's saying that this shooting was obviously racially motivated. I haven't even seen, even Ron DeSantis, who, if anyone was going to say, well, no, we don't know yet, even he came out saying like this was a racially motivated act of violence. But, you know, this is just the latest. This is the latest, right? Of the shooter had written several manifestos filled with like hate ideology. And this is after last year when a shooter killed 10 people in a supermarket in Buffalo. And in 2019, when another man killed 22 people in Walmart in El Paso before telling police he wanted to kill Mexicans. And it's already, like, this year alone, we've seen 400 mass shootings in our country. And this has also happened 2 days, which is today, 2 days before today, and which is the 60th anniversary of Martin Luther King Jr.'s I Have a Dream speech and the March on Washington. And doesn't feel like that's in times like this, it doesn't really feel like we've gone that. We've really reached that any progress. But I know we have to a certain extent, but this is awful. And I don't have anything like more intelligent to say about it because it is just awful. But I also feel like the responsibility of talking about these things when they happen, even whether it's police stuff or like racially motivated stuff, because like we can't just make it be normal and but not talk about it, even if it's like not our state. And
you know, I'm not going to say anything other than the speech that Governor DeSantis gave. People were not impressed with it because
he was booed off, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah, he tried to make it seem like he understood, and people were like, man, you let these laws happen, you let these people flourish, and you have the nerve, you have the audacity to say something like this, and that you think we believe you when you say you care, because you don't, because you're allowing these things happen in your state. So just, you know, it's shameful. It's just shameful, that kind of behavior, to hold it up, and then as soon as it happens, like, we don't like this. This is not Florida. It's exactly for Florida. You created it.
I know. And it's, I just don't know the mental gymnastics he has to go through to think that, like, it is, his hands are totally clean as far as not encouraging an atmosphere of division and, you know, because this, you know, basically so much of what is, granted, he still has not been able to find what woke is, but you know, largely what woke originally was meant to be was state, like it was a, like an AAVE term as far as like black, like in the black language, like black culture, as far as like stay aware and vigilant about the like systemic underbelly of why things are the way that they are, like stay woke as far as like stay aware of these things don't happen randomly. And now it's been turned into whatever gross cliche that like only boomers, like white Republican boomers use it now. But largely the things that originally that was talking about woke was trying to get to continue to fight for social justice and equality around racial lines. And when you continue your fight on wokeness, ultimately is a fight on those things. You're saying like, we want the status quo. We don't want things to get better for the marginalized communities that are trying to fight for these things. Like we want to not feel uncomfortable because that is not, that's icky. So, all right, well, we still have to get to the wasteful. And we also, a legend died over the weekend. So we will get to both of those stories after we come back from the break. Stick around for more As Goes Wisconsin just after this. Welcome back to As Goes Wisconsin. I am Krista Bride. Greg Brock is on the board. And just to round out our last segment of the good, the bad, and the wasteful, France, I know where they could be just funneling this into a lot of people who would buy it, but you know, I guess this is all the supply and demand stuff, but France is about to spend $216 million destroying 80 million gallons of surplus wine. That, so their 80 million gallons of French wine is just going to go down the drain. I don't know. Why does it cost so much money to destroy it? Why don't, like, can't you just pour it out? Like, I'm so confused by this, but that's enough liquid to fill more than 100 Olympic-sized swimming pools. And so The problem is that higher production costs and shrinking demand for wine has made it impossible for French wineries to sell their spiked grape juice for a profit, even if it does have tantalizing hints of oak and leather. But listen to this. So now the average French citizen drinks about 40 liters of wine per year. In 1926, how much do you think it was?
250.
Oh, that's too much.
Okay. 42 liters.
136 liters.
Okay.
But that's still, I mean, that's 100 more. It's 100 more liters of wine than they do now. And
they drink it during the day, like, oh, I'm going to go to work and I'm going to have my wine. I love wine. Ugh. I don't know. That's a, French people, please direct calls to the Chad Holmes show.
Like, I don't know. What do you do with 80 million gallons of wine? And doesn't that just feel so wasteful? Like, I would, like, send me some. Not now.
This whole story was reported.
I will drink that next year.
This whole story was reported. Just send me the wine.
Send me the wine.
I mean,
French wine is very good.
The brewery technical side of my brain wants to say maybe it's not fully fermented. Maybe it is just bad at this point because not all wine is good wine. Some is made cheaper. It's in, like, you know, fermentation vessels or vats, and they're like, we can't. There has to be an explanation, and I know that a lot of American people will be very upset, especially people who like to paint while drinking wine. They're very upset about this. They're very upset.
Well, it reminds me back in the pandemic when there was just footage of farmers just dumping milk down the drain because the supply chains had gotten so screwed up. Yeah. But at least with milk, like, milk goes bad. Yeah. Wine's got like a long shelf life before it goes bad.
I mean, if it's made properly, if it's not open, yeah, I mean, sure. But I'm saying, this might not be the best. This might not be France's best. We don't know. Have you ever seen old footage from like 1930 of agents just walking through distilleries and breweries and just bashing open barrels and letting the beer and the liquor just flow
from like Prohibition?
Yeah. They're just smashing like, no, give me 1 year.
So anyways, but yes, so that wraps up our the good, the bad, and the wasteful. Yeah. But also, RIP, another legend, Bob Barker has died. That the long time The Price is a Right host who kept us company when we were homesick from school, very true. That was like the lineup. I remember when I was homesick from school, it'd be like, I forgot what it would be before Price is Right. But then I would watch like soap operas, fair amount of Price is Right. Especially also in the summer, there was a lot of that. But he died at 99, which many, many, many people loved to make the joke over the weekend that he got as close to 100 without going over as possible.
And something personal for me with Bob Barker, we are birthday twins.
Really?
Same birthday.
There you go. But, you know, he had a very easygoing demeanor. As we referenced Billy Madison earlier in today's show, he also had a very famous Happy Gilmore scene with Adam Sandler.
Which I was going to try to cut, but there really wasn't a lot to, like...
Probably had to like bleep some of it out.
Yeah. So, but just go back. Wrong, bitch.
But did you know that? So he had the show only give away American-made cars during the Call for in 1991, and he was an influential animal rights advocate.
Yes, that I did know.
And he banned fur coats as prizes.
Hey, I mean. I said the same thing after every single show. And I think Drew Carey still says it to this day is don't forget to get your pets spayed or neutered. Like he was an icon in the world of animal rights and taking care of animals. Like he had a building named after him.
Yeah, a PETA office building is named after Bob Barker.
Which I would love to sit down and be like, Bob, come here.
Like PETA?
What do you think? What do you really think about PETA?
But yeah, so he won 14 Daytime Emmy Awards as the host and executive producer. And then in 1999, he won a Lifetime Achievement Emmy.
Heck yeah.
So this is my favorite. So he was 99. He died at home in Los Angeles. His publicist confirmed the death, but did not give a cause. And it's like, he died old. Of old age. Like, he died of being old. Like, do we need to know, like, which body part, like, decided to stop working? Like, there's a certain threshold at some point where it's like, we know the cause. It's fine.
When I was a young person, when a person was over the age of 75, it was always natural. It was always natural causes. It was natural cause. Or it was their time. You know, we didn't care after a certain age. When they're, you know, when they're 22, you're like, oh God, what happened? But 99, like, yeah, dude clocked out. He's done.
I feel like that happened with a Queen Elizabeth, where they're like, oh, there was like some clickbait headline that was like, Queen Elizabeth's cause of death finally revealed. And then you open it, it was like, she was old.
She old, dude. She old. Like,
oh yeah. Yeah. That's what we all thought.
And by the way, just as do yourself a favor, I'm playing the theme song in its full entirety, the intro and the outro. And it's only like 2.5 minutes. Listen to the song. It's a 70s jazz banger. It's the solo in the middle is just absolutely wonderful. I mean,
let's close out this segment early so we can play more of the Price is Right theme song. Listen to it with your music ears though, instead of the TV ears. Really listen for the musicality, for the structure of the
listen. Sound. It's for the notes. It's for the notes you don't hear and play. It's all about the jazz, baby.
All right. Well, when we come back from the top of the hour news, Corey Kaiser is going to be here, who is the owner and founder of Wisconsin Clothing Company and the host of the Shot of Wisco podcast. We're going to talk about his whole brand and content creation, and then at 11:30, we're going to talk about how public health opinions have changed over time, and what will we 40 years from now be saying, wow, I can't believe we thought like that. This is As Goes Wisconsin. Come back in a minute.